In the first video, we went over the installation of RStudio. Now I will explain the basic functionality. I will assume that if you're watching this, you've installed both R and RStudio. I recommend that you also try and knit a file to PDF, as explained in the previous video. If you cannot knit to PDF yet, try instead to knit to HTML or to Word, which will look somewhat similar to what I'll show here. First, let's make sure that we're all looking at the same interface. If you followed the previous video, you'll most likely see these four panes. If this is the case, you can skip about 1 minute ahead into the video. If at any point you accidentally close a pane, or zoom in on one, go to View, Panes, Show All Panes to restore the original view. Also, when you open RStudio for the first time, or if you close all open files in the upper left pane, you will see these three panes instead of all four. If this is the case, open your file from the previous video using File, Open File, and then select your RMD file. Alternatively, you can create a new file by going to File, New File, and then selecting R Markdown. Choose Document and PDF Outputs, and be sure to save your file before continuing. Another difference between what you'll see in RStudio and in this video is that when you first use RStudio, many packages still require installation. Whenever you're prompted to do so, select Yes and wait for the installation to finish before trying again to replicate what I show in the video. Finally, to ensure that what you see in this video is identical to what you see when you use RStudio by yourself, click on the cogwheel next to the Knit button and make sure the following are checked: Preview in Window and Chunk Output in Console. Now let's discuss the actual interface. In the upper left pane, we see the source. This shows the file that we're currently working on. I'll explain everything in this example file in the second half of this video. In the lower left pane, we see the console. This is the instance of R that is currently running. For example, try entering a simple arithmetic operation and press Enter to see the result. You can also store values by creating a variable name followed by a right arrow like this. In the upper right pane, we see the working environment. These are all the datasets, variables, and functions that we entered into R, which are now stored into the computer's internal memory. Since we just stored the variables x and y, we can see that there is a variable named x containing the value 4, and a variable y containing the value 2. We can also view the History tab to see what we entered into R before, although personally, I rarely use this. Lastly, the Connections tab is useful for cloud computing, and the Tutorial tab contains a tutorial that runs from within RStudio. Feel free to give this a try, although I will also introduce another tutorial in the next video. Finally, in the lower right pane, we see the plots made by R. For example, try running the code from the template on the left, which says plot, open bracket, pressure, close bracket. You can do so by pressing the play button, or by clicking anywhere in the line of code and pressing Ctrl Enter. This plots two variables of a standard dataset in R against each other. We can also use this pane to access the help section. The other tabs show the contents of the current working directory, the packages currently installed and/or active, and the last tab can be used to show dynamic plots. The template shown in the upper left pane is an R Markdown file. R Markdown can be rendered as Word, PDF, or HTML. Word is nice for quick and simple editing. PDF tends to look best for viewing and printing by using LaTeX, and HTML is nice for presentations and displaying dynamic content. The idea of R Markdown is simple. Have a single file that can contain a mix of text, code, and output. This allows you to make reports of your analyses without first copy-pasting anything into a different program. This not only removes a potential source of mistakes, but it also makes sure that your figures always look clear. Namely, when you knit to PDF, plots are drawn as vector-based images. This means that you can zoom in as far as you want and the resolution will always be preserved. Now let's discuss what each component in this standard template means. To see more easily what each part does, I recommend that you knit the file to PDF so you can compare code and output side by side. If you can't knit to PDF yet, try knitting to HTML or Word instead, which will look somewhat similar. The top part of the R markdown file shows the preamble. This section is automatically generated when you select the type of file you want to make, like document or presentation. It also changes automatically if you try to knit a file to a different format. Try knitting to HTML, for example, and see what happens to the preamble. The next part shows a chunk of code. Code chunks are highlighted gray and can be collapsed and expanded like this by pressing the arrow. You can also use Alt-0 to collapse everything. You can easily create new code chunks by clicking on Insert. RStudio was originally made for R, but now also supports other languages as you can see over here. You can theoretically mix and match different languages if you want. A code chunk is indicated by 3 backticks, followed by a curly bracket. The letter R then indicates that the code in this chunk should be read as R code. The word setup is just the name of this chunk, and you can change this name if you want. Include equals false means that neither the code in this chunk nor any of its output should be shown in the knitted document. The code in this first chunk turns on echo for all following chunks, which means that not only the output, but also the code should be shown in the PDF. Don't be discouraged by the code in this first chunk, because most code is actually easier to read. Next, we see 3 backticks again, which closes the first chunk. That means that everything after this is treated as text for in the document, rather than code. We then see a hashtag followed by some text. The hashtag turns the text into a header. I'm now going to add some other headers to demonstrate what I mean. This allows for a quick and easy way to add different sections to your report. You can also add bullets like this, or create a numbered list like this. You can view other features of the R markdown language in the cheat sheet, which you can find over here. I'll make a separate video where I go through the entire sheet. What's great about R markdown is that its features work in all formats you knit to. For example, the word over here knit is enclosed by 2 asterisks on either side. This turns the text bold and works in Word, LaTeX, and also HTML. The other 2 chunks show some of the things you can do in R and how you can include them in a knitted document. This chunk produces a simple summary of a standard dataset in R. This last chunk produces a figure from the 2 variables in another standard dataset in R. Note that the echo option has been set to false in the last chunk, meaning that only the output should be shown, the figure, and not the code that produced it. This is also what the creator of this template has written below the chunk. Note that enclosing the text with a backtick on each side makes the code look monospaced, resembling code. That concludes everything in the standard template. Try to adjust some things and then knit again to see how it affects the document. Note that if you add non-code to a chunk, the file won't be able to knit because RStudio can't process your input. Likewise, if you change the opening or closing of a chunk, it may not knit anymore. If this happens, you can always revert a few changes using Ctrl-Z, or you can make a new file from the standard template again. Thank you for watching this video.